when we start to talk about Iran, hold on, let me do this. There we go. When we start to talk about Iran, we need to start with the religious makeup of the country. Remember that Iran is overwhelmingly Muslim, but it is a rarity in the world because it is absolutely dominated by Shia Muslims. So about 90% Shia, about 9% Sunni, and then a smattering of Christians, Jews, Zoroastrians, and Baha'i, amongst others. The Baha'i, remember, always the most singularly prosecuted and persecuted religious group in Iran by a long shot. It is a majority Persian country from a population standpoint, not overwhelmingly. It's maybe 53-55% or so, with a great number of other ethnic groups, nationalities represented, Arabs and Turkmen and Baluchis and Azeris and so forth. So it is definitely a multi-ethnic, multinational state, but the Persian identity is very strong in Iran on the whole. We will hit the Pahlavi dynasty beginning in the 1920s. We had this guy's father, Reza Khan, the illiterate army officer who overthrew the last of the Qajar dynasty back in the 1920s. And then he ruled in a forced industrialization, modernization, authoritarian way for the better part of the next 15 years or so before being deposed in the name of his son, Mohammad Reza Shah. And this is the Shah that we speak to in class so very often. This is the Shah who ruled Iran between 1941 and 79, especially from 1953 to 1979. The Shah of Iran was authoritarian in every way. He was a secular ruler. He was very, very suppressive of civil society, backed by the United States because of his anti-communist and secular views and standpoints. He ran a highly centralized state, used the Savak, the secret police, to keep a lid on his opponents. The religious figures and religious activists were prosecuted, persecuted. Same one for communists. So heavy use of the judicial system, lots of imprisonments, lots of executions. He did try to reform things in the 1960s with some land reform, improving women's rights with a program called the White Revolution in the 1960s. It did not help his standing amongst the broader Iranian society, who were very resentful of his heavy-handed ways. And all of his westernization also was seen as, in Ayatollah Khomeini's words, West-toxification, as Iran was getting West-toxified by those Western values. It was during the Shah's time that Iran became what is known as a rentier state. It's a big term for us in class, you know that. Remember that a rentier state, if we do two definitions for it, the rentier state is one in which the state generates most of its revenue through something other than taxation, whereas a rentier state can also be defined as a state that generates most of its revenue through the sale of a natural resource to foreign countries. And oil fits the bill for Iran. The rentier states in this course are, the big two are Iran and Nigeria, and then Russia also fits the bill right now according to the College Board. But if you get a choice between, to choose two of them, use Iran and Nigeria. It was during the Shah's time that there came to be a very popular nationalist figure named Mohammad Mossadegh, leading a party called the National Front. He was democratically elected as Iran's prime minister in 1951. He called for the nationalization of oil, and he did so, kicking out the British. We had suspicions that he was leaning communist, which then led the Americans and British to overthrow him in Operation Ajax. In 1953, a coup, overthrowing Mossadegh, reinstating the power of the Shah, and then the Shah would go on to solidify his power and rule brutally until 1979. The Islamic Revolution started to get more and more momentum, if you will, in its early stages in the 1970s. You had a Shah that was perceived as being totalitarian, which in reality was true. There was a balance between religiosity and secularism, like I talked about earlier with West toxification. President Jimmy Carter was pressuring the Shah to reduce the human rights violations, allow more civil society, and when that happens, it's very tough to suppress that again, so the Shah wasn't able to do that. There was a general Iranian sentiment that the West was using Iran for its own purposes. And you had a rather formidable coalition come together against the Shah that was, like we've said in class, very strange bedfellows. Religious conservatives, Marxists, the Bazaaris, those who run the informal economy in Iran, collectively very powerful, the urban poor, and the secular intellectuals, the moderate middle class. That coalition would band together, not in a loving, trusting way, but they would work for the ouster of the Shah, and of course the religious conservatives would take control. It all came to be described by a lot of political scientists as a revolution of rising expectations. That is the revolution that takes place when rising expectations give way to disappointment and a setback, and that's the point at which revolution can occur. It is what a lot of people say happened to Iran in the late 1970s. As the Shah cracked down further, the Iranian economy got to be worse. And from suburban Paris, you had the elderly cleric Ayatollah Ruhollah Khomeini, who would lead the Islamic Revolution from afar. Khomeini had been exiled by the Shah following some writings in the 1960s. He ended up living in suburban Paris, and that is the place from which he really drove the revolution, exporting his tapes of his sermon back into Iran so that they could spread his ideas that way. And the Islamic Revolution was unique for us, and it's very different than what we saw in the Soviet Union and China. The revolution was ideological in terms of its, or excuse me, religious in terms of its ideological underpinning. It did lead to a theocracy where we have government based on religious authority, and this was one in which the rural guerrillas played a very marginal role. So this was certainly not Mao's revolution, where you had the peasants playing such a big role in this case. So Ayatollah Ruhollah Khomeini was the supreme leader of Iran. Remember that Ayatollah is the Shia religious title, and supreme leader is the state title. Supreme leader from 1979 until 1989, when he died in June of 89. He led the Islamic Revolution. He personified charismatic, traditional, and authoritarian leadership. He was one who integrated many principles. They were Islamic, of course. He was populist, playing to the people, very nationalist, and he used leftism from an Islamic socialism standpoint. He was one who he and his colleagues did not have governing experience. He famously said that economics is for donkeys when asked about his economic philosophy. And so there was a brain drain in Iran that took place that we'll touch on a little bit later, and they struggled to get their feet early on. The Iran-Iraq War dominated Iran in the 1980s. It created a very nationalist mindset, devastating to the Iranian infrastructure and people. And he did utilize those peristatal foundations to redistribute the wealth of the Shah in that Islamic socialist way, where you had the peristatal foundations known as banyads. The banyads were run by the clerical elite and eventually by the Revolutionary Guard Corps to redistribute the wealth of the Shah and the wealth coming into various businesses and so on. The banyads continue to be used in Iran today, and they are means by which to utilize patronage and enrich people at the top of the banyad. For sure. He also used Islam as an anti-Western ideology, and he was one of the first to do that, did it very successfully. And so the whole death to America thing in Iran very much stems from that particular era.